We have just a couple questions this week, and the main one being someone looking for some phone advice and whether they should get an iPhone, a custom ROM, something else. So we're going to talk about it. And the other question that we see here is about simple login aliases and different ways to simplify that. And so we have a lot of cool stuff to share. Again, these questions come from our patrons. So if you want to ask questions, support the podcast, and also interact with us a little bit more personally, that's the place to do it. And you can check out how to support us down in the description. Usual suspector pretty much is looking for phone advice here. And he or she, I suppose, said they currently have an old iPhone that soon won't get new security updates. So they're wondering how the current state is for phones. And we have a specific phone and OS recommendation. They did test an OS called Vola OS. So far, it seems to work quite well out of the box and it's easy to set up, but they don't like the phone itself, so they're looking for something else. For me, it seems one of the best choices are one of the Pixel phones, as they will get the latest Android versions the fastest. However, if I use stock Android, there's a concern regarding many Google services, and the possibility to install a custom ROM as well exists there. We have iPhones with iOS that, to my knowledge, has a quite good focus on privacy and security, but it comes with the less freedom to customize, and we know a lot of those limitations, which we'll touch on soon. They watched Henry's video, iOS versus Android Privacy Showdown, Beyond the Surface. And yeah, that video is still pretty up to date. It kind of goes through the broader pros and cons of the actual usability differences. And to summarize that video, it goes beyond just technical pros and cons. It's more like, hey, on Android, you're going to get access to third-party app stores and these kind of cool open source tools that might help you in this area. But on iOS, you're going to get access to something like a super easy, seamless end-to-end encrypted suite for all of your data by default, which you can't really emulate on Android easily. So it's kind of pros and cons there. So to summarize the question here, I know this is a big thing, but we're going to get into it. What phones have a good compromise between privacy and security? What OS is best for privacy and security? Stock Android, a custom ROM, or iOS? What consequences does it have that Google has made it harder to build custom ROMs? Okay, there's a lot to unpack here. So I want to start by saying I do think it's really good for people to reflect on just as a concept iOS versus Android, just broadly. And it's just kind of what I already spoke to. On iOS, everything is WebKit based. There's only one centralized app store. There's no real F-Droid. There's not a huge awesome open source community collection of things that you can utilize. VPNs are a bit iffy on iOS. There's no like real proper system-wide VPN. There's no official Tor browser for iOS. You're not going to be able to use profiles and install Signal twice on your phone. So it's going to be a lot more restricted. With that said, everything will work on iOS. There is no, oh, does this work? Does this not work? You can access your banking app in your browser. You can access it with the official app. You still have access to a lot of cool privacy tools, and you can still be an overall private person on iOS. Those are my general beliefs on it. And where iOS really excels right now, at least, is Apple's advanced data protection. I really do think that if Google was able to offer something like that, it would make stock Android much more competitive to iOS right now. But the reality is that on Android, there is no way to have a super nice, seamless, clean ecosystem with end-to-end encryption. You are going to have to fill it in and pretty much patch with various services, which is very possible, right? This means getting Proton Mail for email, which you'd have to do on iOS anyway, because that's not covered by their end-to-end encryption. But you're going to have to use Entei for photos. You're going to have to use something for your notes. You're going to have to use something for backups. I do think Google does have encrypted backups now, so that is one area that they've closed up. But my point is, iCloud, literally everything except calendar, email, and contacts would be end-to-end encrypted. And that's just built into the ecosystem. It's the same exact feature set, and you don't have to change anything. So I would say kind of reflect on those things. And then on the Android side of things, you're going to get access to F-Droid, Aurora, third-party app stores, really cool firewall plus VPN tools that just don't exist on iOS. So it's really going to come down to your use cases, and you have access to multiple accounts, profiles, etc. And it's a much more open ecosystem, like you alluded to. These aren't things you probably don't already know, but I'm saying these things for the broad listeners. Now, to answer your question, what phones have a good compromise between privacy and security? I think Nate and I would say your go-to options are going to be, yes, this plain iOS, if that works with your workflow and what you're looking for from a privacy perspective, stock Android, and then, yes, some of these custom ROMs. We can't really answer this directly for you, though, because it's really hard to know who you are and what kind of like workflow you're looking to have. Which OS is best for privacy and security? Probably a really solid custom ROM as a whole, if you're looking for like the overall best option, but you're also going to lose out on some other things as well if you go that route. And like you said, things are looking a little bit shaky right now, but I wouldn't make all of your decisions based on things just maybe looking shaky, because we don't have reason to think that anything is going to go away anytime soon either. The cool thing is you already use an iPhone, and so you already know what that ecosystem looks like. So maybe what I would ask you is, what were you unhappy with your iPhone? Because the only reason you're switching it out is because it's running out of security updates. So what did you feel like was missing from your iPhone that would take your privacy and security journey to the next level? And ask yourself, okay, well, based on what we just shared and based on what you already know, does Android actually patch up those issues that you have? So I would really tie it more to the experience you've already been having and see, oh, okay, so which like option actually resolves my concerns the best? That's what I would do personally.
I mostly agree on a lot of points. I guess to summarize, what phones have a good compromise between privacy and security? I say this on The New Oil, actually. I have a whole section about mobile devices. The only two phones I recommend paying money for are iPhones and Pixels. Y'all know I have a beef with Samsung. If somebody gave me a Samsung phone, I would chuck it in the river. But pretty much anything else, I would be like, oh, thanks. I guess I'll figure out something to do with this. But you won't catch me dead walking into a store and paying for a Motorola or a... Well, I guess maybe Motorola if Calyx stops supporting Pixels for some reason.
What are your thoughts on Fairphone? Because I actually don't mind them either.
I would be interested to try a Fairphone. I've never had one because when I first discovered them, they were only sold in Europe and I didn't know how to get my hands on one.
They still mostly are, but I guess you can like Marina kind of sells them is what it is, right?
I think so, yeah. That was actually kind of my backup plan when the whole thing with like the Pixel device tree going away came out and we were still kind of trying to understand it, is I was like, well, if I can't flash a Pixel anymore, I'll probably get my hands on a Fairphone and start, because I don't use SIM card anyways, so what do I care if it's not in the right band for America? But yeah, I'd be interested to try it. So yeah, I think iPhone and Pixel are going to be your best bet. What OS is best for privacy and security? I will go ahead and say I think it's Graphene. I think they really do strip a lot of stock stuff out. They obviously do a lot of hardening. In this week's episode, I mentioned how if you go read Calyx's documentation, there is a reason that they do a lot of the things they do. So for example, one of the things they get criticized for is they still do DNS checks with Google. And their logic is that, first of all, nothing sensitive gets handed over during a connection check except your IP address, which Calyx ships with like two or three free VPNs by default. And number two, well, number three, you can change connectivity checks to turn off if you want. But number two is they are going with the whole idea of like blending in with the traffic, as opposed to using a custom server. So Graphene, for example, they do connectivity checks with their own servers. So it's, you know, what we said in the main episode is like, it's just a different approach. They're trying to do different things. Graphene is trying to de-Google as much as humanly possible, or as much as technically possible, while Calyx is trying to find a balance between like privacy, but blending in. Like, it's just different philosophies. So that is why I say, like, I think Graphene is the most private and secure, but I think things like Calyx are still going to be a hell of a lot better than stock Android. When it comes down to like stock Android versus iOS, I would argue that stock iOS is more private and secure. But at the same time, I also argue that you can make a lot of meaningful changes to Android. You can use it without ever having to sign in. Like Henry said, you can replace a lot of the apps with privacy respecting apps. You can use like Aurora Store and F-Droid and things like that. You can also use ADB to nuke a lot of the stock apps, which for the record, I've heard conflicting reports. Like some people say it basically just hides the app, but either way, it's still going to be a lot more private than signing in and using it the way it was intended. You said that there's an issue of some custom ROMs don't get security updates as fast. First of all, maybe we should stop talking about Calyx because that has been temporarily removed from the board if you're not an existing user. But with Graphene, they are notorious for sometimes pushing updates faster than Google. I've heard that claim. I've never seen it personally, but they are fast. I follow the Graphene changelog and 90% of the time I see like Ars Technica is like, oh, Google released their monthly security update today. Here's what's in it. And then anywhere from like later that day to 2 days later, Graphene is like, here's the full patch. And then the last thing you said, what are the consequences that Google has made it harder? We don't know. We're still feeling that out. Right now, the main consequence seems to be slowed development time, but it still remains to be seen how that's going to play out long-term. Something I did forget to talk about in the main episode is I've heard some people speculate that AOSP is kind of circling the drain and may not be around much longer. I don't think that's going to happen anytime soon, like within the next 12 to 18 months at least, which I know is kind of a short time frame when we're talking about buying a phone that gets like 7 years of security updates. But right now, Google is still under a lot of scrutiny for antitrust and anti-monopoly stuff, and actually just took an L recently with the Play Store, I think it is, and sideloading and stuff like that. So I don't think we're going to wake up tomorrow and see a headline that like Google has killed AOSP. I think we've still got a little bit of life left in it. But if you want to think worst case scenario and ask yourself, what would I do if AOSP goes away? then I think we're back to what Henry said at the end, which is it really comes down to you. It comes down to what are your values? Like the reason I moved away from iPhone is because I wanted access to those custom ROMs. And ironically, I also wanted access to some of those Android-only apps like Briar. And now that I'm on a custom ROM, there's a lot of iPhone-only or Mac-only security apps that are really interesting that I wish I could try out, but I don't have an iPhone at the moment. So yeah, like what are you looking for? Are you looking for ease of use and security? Then I think iPhone is probably going to be the way to go. Are you looking for maximum level of privacy? Then yes, you should definitely get a Pixel and put a custom OS on it. It really depends on what you want and also what works for you. And I guess the last thing I'll say is the saving grace of a custom OS is that all of them offer instructions for how to roll back to stock. So if you buy a Pixel and you try Graphene and it doesn't work, like the app doesn't work on your phone, and you try Calyx, well, you can't try Calyx right now, but hypothetically, you try Calyx and the app doesn't work on your phone, you can always put stock Android right back on there and it'll work just fine. So it may not be ideal and it may not be preferable to iOS, depending on how you feel about that. I know that's a very divisive topic. Divisive? I don't know what word I'm looking for. But the thing you can rest easy in is knowing that you will not be up a creek. You will have a usable phone. And our second question this week came from Yalvim. I don't know how to pronounce that. I'm sorry. You said, hey there, thanks for your time and great work. Thank you for your patience with episodes lately, from me to all of you. You said, I'm looking at my simple login aliases and I'd like to clean it up. Getting the premium version would be the way to go. You said, you will have many more domain names. From what I understand, it isn't specifically useful to most people. I just want a cleaned up and per service email. So I have like mybank@mydomain.com, twitch@mydomain.com. However, if I share this account with a partner, they would use their own domain to separate. I'm a Proton user, but did not link my account to simple login because not all eggs in the same basket in terms of password. I only pay for the VPN, so I don't really care for the other advantages. So your questions, how should I use domain names like I suggest above or not? Would there be any chance of getting blocked because it's not a mainstream domain? What advice would you give to create a domain name except from shorter is better and easy to write or pronounce? How useful is it really having a per-service email when I only have access to one phone number living in the EU? Thanks in advance. Okay, so how to use domain names? There's a lot of different ways to go about this. Okay, so first of all, I've written a few blog posts about this, and I made a video about this, which I should probably redo because I've kind of simplified since then. So first of all, I really want to address, there is this concern that I see a lot in the community where if you have a custom domain, doesn't that make you easier to track? And I don't think so. Now, this I don't have any evidence for this either way, but here's my logic. 99% of people are using Gmail, Yahoo, MSN, Outlook, something like that, right? And 99% of people only have, I think the average is like 2.5 emails or just under 2 emails. So most people have like a personal email, a professional email, and maybe like a spam email. So if they're signing up for something they know is going to get like shopping or newsletters, and then they have like one email for job hunting, and then they have one email for like emailing grandma, things like that. So it doesn't make sense to say, let's find everybody using Gmail when Gmail has 70% of the email market. They're going to look at specific email addresses. They're looking for how many people are using joerogan@gmail.com and how many times does that email show up. The only thing I want to suggest is I would not use mybank@mydomain.com because I'm about ready to start throwing punches at people who do not understand how email works. Because I have gone to so many places now where I show up and I'm not expecting to turn over email. So I just make up an email address on the spot because wildcard. So I'll go to, let's say, Olive Garden. I go to Olive Garden and they're like, hey, if you sign up for the newsletter, you get $5 off your meal. And I'm like, sure, I can always delete it later. So olivegarden@mydomain.com. And I swear they give me the most deer in the headlights, confused look. And they're like, Olive Garden at my, do you work for Olive Garden? And it's like, no, it's just an email address. Wait, how do you have an Olive Garden email address? And it's like, oh my God, just. So now I've literally just started looking around the room and I'm like, microphone@mydomain.com. Like
microphone in Olive Garden.
Yes, exactly. I don't know why I brought a microphone to Olive Garden, but apparently I did. But yeah, so like seriously, stay away from twitch@mydomain.com because like that is just asking for confusion and you're going to get so frustrated. What advice would you give to create a domain name? I don't know. I think you hit the nail on the head. Whatever you need. I would just say something that you're not ashamed to say out loud and share with people would be the main one. And how useful is it to have a per service email? I use the crap out of it. Personally, I don't know what that has to do with phone number. I don't really hand out my phone number very often, to be honest. Maybe it's different in Europe, but around here, I make a new email address for everything because a lot of these data breaches we cover, what do they have? Email address, password, IP address, username, usually a hash password if they're doing things right. There's not a lot of them that have phone. I mean, some of them have phone number, but it's not as common as email address. And then I also know exactly where the breach is coming from. When I start getting spam and I log into Simple Login and I'm like, oh, it's coming from here. And then on top of it, I can feel safe nuking that email address. Like, I don't have to go like, oh, but if I shut this off, there's like five other things that I'm getting emails for now. Like, just, oh, cool. Yeah, I hope that was coherent. I don't know. I feel like that was extra rambly, but I think that's all I got.
Yeah, I guess all I can share is what I do. I just use simple login aliases for everything. I don't see many reasons not to. And for me, it's even more than privacy. It's a usability thing, because then I am able to tell exactly where an email, spam email, came from. I can disable an email just like that, and it's no big deal. And I can also swap out the behind-the-scenes mailbox and freely move between mail providers. So for me, it's purely a usability thing. And also, I use Proton Pass. So it's literally just as easy for me to put in. It's actually easier for me to like use Proton Pass's generate alias email than it is for me to type out a known email, if that makes sense. So it's literally just more convenient for me. There's one thing I have been thinking about. So this is my counterpoint, and I don't know if I'm going to do this yet. Something changed in the last couple of years, or maybe like the last year, when it comes to like verification of identities, especially when it comes to opening bank accounts in the US. And I talked about this quite a bit with Douglas in an interview on TechLore, who runs a service called Privacy Post. And what this is, it's like a private mailbox service, a private mailing service. And he actually does everything through Proton and through Signal. So it's like end-to-end encrypted. It's a pretty cool service. And, you know, he was talking about too how these credit bureaus, bank accounts, et cetera, they're using really sophisticated ways now to like essentially crack down on people using private mailboxes for their address. And I've had issues with this. So when I apply for a new bank or anything like this, I've been having quite a few issues when it comes to using typically addresses that are fully okay for me to use. The reason I bring this up is that some of these, when I dug into a bit more of like the privacy policies, some of them do seem to verify by email as well. Like if this is like a legitimate request. I don't know how true that is, or like how much these things are massive black boxes, so we don't know. But it's made me maybe just want to establish like a credit slash bank centralized unified email. So it's like, yeah, this is my actual email. And then it's literally only used for that and nothing else, if that makes sense, just to kind of plant that flag. I don't know if it'll make a difference. It's purely speculative, purely hypothetical. I wouldn't recommend people just do this unless it doesn't really impact them. But that's something I've been considering doing recently. Otherwise, I use aliases for literally everything else and still do. I still haven't made this switch.
So you don't use a lot of custom domains?
No, I actually haven't even linked a custom domain to my simple login account.
So the only reason I've started leaning into custom domains is because if in the future I ever want to switch from Simple Login to someone else, that kind of future-proofs me. I can go, whether Simple Login shuts down or I just stop wanting them for whatever reason, somebody else offers a better deal, I can move my custom domain to the other provider. And especially if I can enable wildcard, and boom, they're all just there.
That's pretty cool. And so that is it for the Q&A this week. Again, we gave a lot of thoughts on phone stuff. Hopefully there's something useful there. I know we shared a lot. And then also a lot of thoughts on alias emails. We want to thank you all for asking questions. We appreciate you for not just asking them, but supporting what we do and making it so that we can keep this podcast hopefully growing for years and years. So thank you all for listening, engaging, and being a part of things. And you can also join next week's Q&A already right now by going down in the description and supporting us either on XMR chat through Monero or on Patreon. We'll see you next time.